Welcome to our lecture, Computational Finance, Applied Mathematical Finance. In this session, I like to do a small recapitulation of what was done in the numerical methods lecture and what is maybe useful for the upcoming lecture. So actually what comes now is, say, the numerical methods lecture in, well, a single session, yeah, compressed to a single session. Some of the results can be used as a black box, but it's maybe important to see them again. So don't be afraid if you do not understand everything. We will hint to the results when we need it. Okay, so let's start with a prominent application for mathematical finance, and this is the universal pricing theorem. Yeah, first remark, universal pricing theorem. I do not like the name pricing so much, yeah, because it's actually a valuation that is performed here. Pricing is maybe done by a market, and this theorem tells me how I can calculate a value, and that's also here if you look below the final result. So this theorem tells me that I can express the time t value, so important part here is the word value, of a financial derivative. And so what does it mean, calculating a value? So what is the value of a certain object? So for example, if you have your favorite cup, yeah, so this is my favorite cup. What is the value of this cup? Maybe it has a special value to me and no value to you. So by value, here we understand the value of a replication portfolio. And a replication portfolio is, when speaking of my favorite cup, the cost to create a cup that is identical. Yeah? For example, if I can buy this cup on the market, it is the price of the cup on the market. So the replication portfolio. And then I have a small theorem that tells me that I can express this expectation, value here as some expectation and an expectation of some random variable. And this random variable here is, well, given by a future value of this financial derivative. So I see here again the value V. Yeah. So it is the time t, capital T value of the financial derivative. Okay, so maybe you have an option and you know that the future value of this option is given as, okay, here in the script you see it's given as a function. So this here is a function. Maybe I take a little bit different pen here. So this here is a function of some objects x of t1, x of tn, and these are objects that describe a state of my financial market. So what we have here in blue is the stochastic differential equation that describes how these x, so these are random variables, x of t1, x of tn. So x is a stochastic process, so it's an Itô process. How these are modeled. Yeah? So this here is a model. Okay. And it is a model of, say, objects that describe my financial markets. Okay, so why do I use here the complicated word objects? Yeah, an example could be an asset, the value of an asset. So for example, a stock. Yeah. Okay, so I could just use they model assets. Well, it could also be derived quantities. for example, interest rates, which also describe the market. Okay, so when we do interest rate modeling, maybe the X is not the value of some traded asset, it is the value of an interest rate, yeah? So something that describes the state of the market, which is in the end, as we will see, associated with some traded asset. Okay, and maybe you remember that this universal valuation theorem then works the following way. You choose a special asset N, which is your numerator. Then if you can move to the corresponding equivalent martingale measure, so this means that, okay, what does it mean that we have a martingale measure here? It means that the ratio of the value of a traded asset traded on the market. So this one divided by the value of the numerator is a martingale. A martingale means that the expectation of the future value conditional to time little t is the time little t value. And this property will then persist also for all derivatives, which means that I can finally use this property to calculate also the values of the financial derivatives. You see that what's below here is just the martingale property for V divided by N. So I can express now the value of a financial derivative that is given as a function of model quantities as an expectation. So all the objects here, so the x of t's, they are random variables. So this is a random variable. This guy is a random variable. So then it means also that a function of a random variable is a random variable. Okay, so then we have, of course, some implementation that represents a random variable. If you represent a random variable on a finite state space, that's just a vector of some realizations, some states. Yeah, and maybe we can also peek into some code here. And we have an implementation here for a random variable. And you see that this random variable is just nothing else but, okay, forget about all the other lines, just a vector of certain values, certain scenarios, certain scenario values. Okay, so we need the concept of a random variable. So the theory which you need here, related to this theorem is random variables, Brownian motions, Itô processes, Itô's lemma. Yeah? So a function of a stochastic process is also a stochastic process. Then Itô's lemma is a nice tool here related to Itô processes, Gezanov theorem. We will comment on these guys when we need them, but this is the stuff that is behind this nice application. A classical example for this is the Black-Scholes model, a very simple model. So in the Black-Scholes model, our market has just two assets. So there is here the numerator, which is just a bank account. You can think of it as a bank account. So this guy is given here by an ODE. Yeah? So you can write dN by dt is rn. Yeah? So you see that what we have here is that n of t is just n of t zero times exponential rt minus t zero. Okay, so this is one asset on the market, and the other asset on the market is now modeled here by some stochastic process. Okay, so you see that this stochastic process for S has here in front of the dt part, which I call the drift, the same parameter r. But then it also has some additional part here, which is a random disturbance around this drift part here. So if you like to draw a small picture. Okay, so how does this look like? So you see that for n, that was in the dark blue color here, n, I start in n0, and then I have maybe some exponential growth, okay? So maybe this here is n0. Maybe s starts at a different level, yeah? So that here is s0, and we have the same exponential growth, but I also have around this line, I have now some random disturbances, random paths walking around this line. So this here is now my S of t and omega. So there is some randomness here, and the randomness is coming here from this guy, which is the Brownian motion, the infinitesimal increment of the Brownian motion. So you know that W is such that Ti plus one, if you look at discrete time steps, minus Ti is normal distributed. So that is a model for the values I observe on my market. Okay, maybe look like that. Okay, and this line here was just to illustrate that there is the underlying drift, yeah, which is similar, but in the end, all the paths here for S are random. Okay, so I can express maybe a random variable in the code. So we need to perform calculations in the computer. It is maybe nice to recall again that computations in the computer may have issues. So it's good to understand the computer arithmetic. Let me very shortly recall, what it is about here. So the computer can, of course, not represent all the real numbers. He can only represent a subset of the real numbers. So this set of the floating point numbers is a subset of the real numbers. Well, it's actually much simpler. So it's given here, f is the set of the floating point numbers, the numbers which are represented in the computer. And this set is constructed from, say, a set of integers. There is s, which is just 0 or 1, which decides which sign we have. And then there is an integer number e, which is in a certain range. So yeah, you see here there's a certain range for e. And there's another integer number c, which is here in this range from 0 to 2 to the power of p. And these ranges, well, they have a certain choice. For example, for double precision floating point numbers, you have these values. And if we start by looking at the parameter e, then we see there is here 2 to the power of e, which somehow allows now to generate the numbers. Let me draw this here. Okay, so what numbers do we have? Maybe I have the number 1, 2 to the power of 0, 2, 4, and maybe 8. Yeah? So something like that. Maybe I also have 2 to the power of minus 1, 1 half, 1 over 4. So we have a few smaller ones. Then I can also create the negative guys. So I have the same on the other side. Yeah, 1 over 4, 1 over 2, 1, 2, 4, maybe 8. Yeah. Okay, and you see that in between, the number 0 is actually missing. That is not in the set. Okay, so here is the number 0, which is not in this first set. So that this is what is done here by this 2 to the power of e. And you see the guy in front here, this guy is between 1 for c equals 0. And it is between, well, 2 not included. Because if you like to switch to 2, you just increase this guy here. So we have here a part that is discretizing a few numbers here in between. And it's just an equidistribution of each interval. So the smaller intervals get all the same numbers, but a little bit more dense. Okay, so this is now the blue part, yeah, the first part here, which I've drawn in this line. It is on this timeline. Oh yeah, on this number line. And a third part is then everything that is around the 0. Okay, so this is just here an equidistribution of this small interval that we have left out here. Okay, and then we are almost complete. Okay, there are two other guys. Here it is minus infinity and plus infinity. So you can think of them being numbers sitting here at the end. Okay, so why is that? Because we have, when we perform an arithmetic operation, we have a rounding. So very important is now the rounding. Okay, and what does the rounding mean? When I have an arithmetic operation, for example, I have here this number and this number, and these two numbers now enter into some arithmetic operation. Yeah, whatever you do, you add them, you subtract them, whatever. And then the result is, for example, by coincidence, this number, then the result cannot be represented in the computer, and the result is rounded to the nearest representative. So the result is here. Yes, you do not get the exact result, you get some rounded result. So you just get some nearest representative. The rounding is here this function float. Yeah, very simple stuff, but you have to understand that the computer can only represent certain numbers, and this rounding can lead to very surprising effects. Yeah, so we had a few examples in the other session. Yeah, if you are interested, just as a small remark, the root of all evil is that if you add a very small number, this epsilon here to some other number, yeah, that is compared to epsilon large, say 1, then it may be just vanishing. The epsilon may be too small, the result may be rounded back to 1. Yeah? So it is as if the operation never happened, which is a problem. Just to illustrate you, just to illustrate this, let's have a look at this very small computer program. Yeah, so very small program here, where I like to perform exactly this. So I have a number x is 1, then I have a very small number epsilon is 10 to the minus 16, and then I just calculate y, which is x plus epsilon. And now I ask myself, okay, what is y? Okay, so well, y is 1 plus 10 to the minus 16, this is 1.123456789101216. Huh? So it is this number. And then I check, is x equal to y? Okay, so you maybe know this here is the Boolean expression, is x equal to y? Let's run this little program. And you see that x plus epsilon is actually 1, okay? So it's rounded back to 1. We lose the precision. And the computer thinks that x is equal to y. So surprising effect, fundamental mathematical properties are violated in this calculation. Yeah? So x should not be equal to y. And this effect may lead to, say, strange results. Already when you calculate a sum of large numbers and small numbers. So, and it is for that reason, if you look again at our little random variable, so which I have already shown to you here, then this random variable, it provides a certain function. And there's, for example, also the function to calculate the average, the expectation of all these numbers. And you see that this summation here, calculating the sum, looks a little bit more complicated because it does some error correction. Yeah? So one has to be careful when one does this. So this is all hidden from you. You can think of it as a black box, but I just wanted to mention that there is this issue. So the next thing I would like to recall is the Monte Carlo method, because it will also be used when we discuss models later, when we study our implementations. The Monte Carlo method allows me to approximate an expectation. Okay, so first, maybe you recall the strong law of large numbers. Yeah. So there is some random variable z given. So it's a d-dimensional real valued random variable. And now assume that you can construct a sequence of other random variables, which I call zi. And this sequence of random variables is such that they all have the same distribution than z. Yeah? So an independent sequence of random variables. Then if I take a look here at the sum of zi from I equals 1 to n divided by n, so it is the average over the sequence up to element n, so somehow the time average, if the I is associated with time, then this converges as n goes to infinity to the expectation of the random variable, and all the random variables have the same distribution, so it's the expectation of z. Okay, so maybe in the theorem it's missing, but here it's important. These guys are IID. Of course, it's a sequence of independent random variables. Well, why is that useful? Okay, actually, at this point, it doesn't look so useful because I'm constructing an object, which is here this Sn, and this Sn looks more complicated than the thing which we have started with, the random variable z. But you can make this become a nice approximation method. Before I come to this, we already have some convergence results. Sort of from Chebyshev formula, you can derive this property. The probability that your approximation, so you're running average here, 1 divided by n, the sum of zi, deviates from the true solution, so from this expectation here, mu, so mu is the expectation. by more than some epsilon. So here this epsilon is the error. This probability can be estimated. So it is smaller here than this expression. And you see that this thing here goes to zero. So the probability that we deviate by more than epsilon goes to zero if n goes to infinity. Yeah? So we can make the probability that we deviate from a given value, we can make that probability small, well, by a certain substitution. So if you just substitute epsilon as sigma, which is the variance here of the random variable, the standard deviation sigma squared is the variance divided by square root of delta times square root of n. If you perform this substitution, then the error, of course, now looks like that. And if you plug this in to the right hand side, you have now a new parameter here, this parameter delta, which I introduced here. Okay. Which is now a given probability. So if you like to have a given error probability, then you see that the error here goes to zero. So the deviation from the true solution goes to zero and it converges a little bit here like one divided by square root of n. Okay, so four times the number of random variables here give you half the error. Everything just holds here in probability. So important observation is that everything here holds just in probability, though there is this p still in front. So we cannot be 100% sure. Yeah. So we just have an expression that the probability is below a certain or is below a certain bound. Okay, so you can convert this method into an integration method by a very small substitution. This is then called Monte Carlo integration, which is maybe nice because it now also illustrates why this is an interesting method. If you consider the special case where this random variable z is a function f of a random variable x, where x is uniform. So a uniform random variable, I know the density. Yeah, the density is just dx. So it's just one. Yeah. So then I have now the result that this running sum here. So one divided by n f of xi. Xi now a sequence of iid uniform distributed random variables. Well, this converges to, okay, so where does it converge to? This converges to the expectation of f of x. But since x is uniform, I know that I can write this as the integral f of little x dx, where dx, where x is from my interval 0, 1, yeah, in d dimension, 0, 1, d. So you see that this can be seen as converging to here the integral. So for a fixed n, this can be seen as an approximation of an integral. So it is an integration method. So this is called the Monte Carlo integral. And of course, you can also conclude the convergence result, yeah, from the previous slide, where I just replaced the expectation of z here with this integral. And why am I mentioning this? mentioning this because there is a magic property of the Monte Carlo method, which is not seen in classical integration methods. And it's really, really worth to mention this again. The magic thing is that the convergence, so here this was our convergence, or also here this probability, all this does not depend on the dimension d. So you see the parameter d, the dimension of the function which I integrate, does not occur in this convergence rate. So the magic of the Monte Carlo method is that this stuff here, the convergence speed, does not depend on the dimension d. This is important for us because if you look at interest rate models, these models are often high dimensional. We will have a nice example of a very high dimensional model, 40, 80, 120 dimensions or even more. It's no problem. Also, if you think of stochastic processes, the number of time steps is often also entering into the dimension. Okay, so that is the magic of the Monte Carlo method. And actually it's a little bit related to the fact that everything here holds only in probability. There's still this disturbing P here in front of that. And to conclude my little recapitulation of the Monte Carlo method, let's just recall, we will use this in a pointwise manner. So I will just look at, say, a single event, omega. Okay, then if I do this, this will create, not from the random variable, it will extract a single number. So X, capital XI of omega is now little xi, and this little xi is a random number. So I have a sequence here of random numbers. So you see on the left-hand side, there is just the average of a sequence of function evaluations on random points. And then I use this to approximate the expectation. So I consider this now as an approximation. So here I use it in a pointwise manner to approximate this expectation. And this may be a little bit puzzling because my previous result is such that I know that only the probability that I'm close is say small. But now I use a single point, and it's not guaranteed that this point is close, but there is a theory that maybe also justifies this a little bit, the other quasi Monte Carlo methods. So they're also, say, pointwise estimates. But in general, if you do not have quasi-random numbers, so you cannot be sure that this is a good approximation. And but we can maybe check this. Okay, so and now you see that although I have started with here an object which is more complicated than the stuff that I would like to derive, the expectation here of a single random variable, here I have many random variables, now I just have a very simple expression, just generate random numbers and evaluate your function. And you also see how this relates back to our original problem. I like to calculate an expectation of a random variable, and this random variable here is a function of other random variables. So I just simulate drawings of this random variable and calculate the expectation. Speaking of random numbers. Yeah, how does the computer generate random numbers? Small remark. So there is there are many implementations that generate pseudo random sequences. Pseudo random number generators that generate uniform random numbers, uniform on 0, 1. So for sequences of uniform distributions, we just use some given random number generators. And then sometimes for our application, we need sequences of other distributions. So if you look back, I mentioned the Brownian motion. The Brownian increment is normal distributed. So how can I generate a normal distributed random number? So there is a little lemma that allows me to generate a sequence of normal distributed random number. So a normal distributed random number sequence, so a sequence of another distributions, if I know the inverse of the distribution function. And if you don't know the inverse of the distribution function analytically, sometimes they are very highly accurate approximations. So if you know this inverse of the distribution function, so this is F inverse here, there is a nice little lemma. So you take a uniform sequence, you apply the inverse F, and you get an F distributed sequence. Yeah, so here the X is then an F distributed sequence. So apply, for example, the inverse of the normal distribution to a uniform sequence, and you have a normal distributed sequence. If we do not have an inverse of the normal distribution function, then maybe we have a nice approximation. Okay, I can also show this in the code. I already mentioned the Brownian motion. So you see somewhere here is also an implementation of a Brownian motion. Well, for example, here, and in this implementation, there is at a certain location the code that generates a uniform random number using a well-known random number generator, and from that, using this inversion of the distribution function. Yeah, so here, it generates the normal distributed random number. Okay, so somewhere hidden in the Brownian motion is this little lemma. Yeah, that was a small recap of the Monte Carlo method. So next topic is time discretization of stochastic differential equations. So in my application here, you see that we have a stochastic differential equation here. Okay, so I know how I can create maybe a single time step of the Brownian motion, but here this is written for a continuum. Yeah, so there is a dt here and a dw. So how do you actually generate out of this model? How do you generate the realizations x at certain time points? So this topic is the time discretization of stochastic differential equations. So first remark, this way of writing the model, so this here is our Itô process. This is just a short notation. Okay, so, and it is a short notation because what's missing here, so what has been dropped is actually that you apply the integral sign from 0 to t or some other bound, yeah, so t is here just an arbitrary bound. Yeah, and also zero, you could use now s from s to t. So let's apply the integral sign from zero to t. Then if you apply the integral sign to the dx, this is actually just, integral from zero to t dx is x of capital T minus x of zero. Okay, then I can move the x of zero to the other side. And now I have the expression x of capital T is x zero plus the integral over this stuff here. Yeah. So it is the integral over mu dt and the integral over sigma dw. So this here is sometimes called the drift part. And this here is sometimes called the diffusion part. Okay, so now we've seen this is just a short notation, but can I now calculate x of, say, capital Ti, or at a certain point, x of T1? So maybe not yet, but if you use this, say, with a certain fixed time discretization, so I consider now here a given time discretization, Ti plus one, and so on as a time discretization. So I apply the integral from Ti to Ti plus one. So I have Ti plus one is equal x of Ti plus the integral over the drift part, Ti plus one, mu T x of T dt plus the integral over the diffusion part. Sorry, maybe this guy here has to go out of the way. T x of t dw. And now let's make a small trick. Yeah, so let's just fix the coefficients. So approximate this by using, say, sigma at the starting point. Okay, then this is a constant, can be moved in front of the integral. So sorry, there is also here the Ti to Ti plus one, of course. And the same with the mu coefficient. So I approximate this now with mu at the starting point, and then this is a constant and can be moved in front of the integral. Okay, then this means that this stuff here changes to x at the next time step is x at the previous time step plus this constant times integral over dt is just delta ti, yeah, ti plus one minus ti. And the same here for the diffusion part. So this constant sigma times delta w of ti, delta w is just the integral dw, which is w of ti plus one minus w of ti. Well, not exactly, because since I have done an approximation here, these are now approximations. So they are not the same value as x, but a value that is maybe close to x. And because I do not know the true x, I also cannot plug in the true x here. So I use the coefficient at the beginning of the time interval with this approximation. Okay, and when you have this, you see T0 is your initial value, and the initial value is given here. So you see that in that case, I have now a way of constructing the new random variable for the next time step out of the previous one. So this here is a well-known numerical method. This is the so-called Euler time discretization scheme for stochastic processes. And the only thing you know, the only thing you need here is how do you generate this random variable here? But we have seen this. This is just a normal distribution that we have to generate here. So draw uniform random numbers, convert them to normal distributed random numbers, and plug this in into this guy here and generate the next time step. So this is the so-called Euler scheme. So given a stochastic process here, we consider a time discretization, and then we can define the Euler approximation x tilde, which is actually given by freezing the coefficients, the drift and the diffusion coefficients, so such that we have piecewise constant coefficients. So for your coefficients here, you have that the delta t is multiplied with the mu. So this is just the time step size, and the delta w is multiplied with the sigma. This delta w is the Brownian increment. Yeah, okay, so we may also look at some code, you know, where this is done. We will use this maybe a little bit like a black box, you know, but there is somewhere here also code related to stochastic processes. And here there is an Euler scheme. Okay, and you see somewhere here below, there's a little bit of stuff going on. There is here, the new state is the old state plus the drift, yeah, and the drift part. Okay, so if you look to the right, the drift part is here the product of mu times delta t. So this here is the mu. And then the diffusion part, the new state is the old state plus the factor loading. So factor loadings is sometimes the word I use for the sigma coefficient times the Brownian increment. Okay, so this is sigma delta W. And you see this Brownian increment here. Yeah, if you take a look at this, this is taken here from this stochastic driver, which is our Brownian motion. Okay, so there is an implementation somewhere of this Euler scheme, which we will use to generate time discretizations of stochastic processes. We also have convergence results. So there is a so-called strong convergence, which has convergence order 1/2. So what does this mean? So there is here the parameter h to the power of 1/2. And what is this h? H is the time step size. Okay. So actually, if you have non-uniform discretization, it is the maximum time step size. But if you have a uniform discretization, then it is just the time step size. So as you increase the number of time steps, your approximation, so this guy here is your approximation, becomes closer to the true solution. There's also the so-called weak convergence, and the weak convergence does not look here at the supremum of this difference at overall time steps. It looks at a fixed time. So we have for any fixed time, and it looks at a test function. So we have for any fixed time t and any Lipschitz continuous test function f, that we only look at the difference of the expectation of f of x and the expectation of f of x tilde. So the expectation of a function of our approximation and the expectation of a function of the true solution at certain times. And maybe you believe this is a very weak form of comparing two objects. I only consider the expectation here, and I only consider this for test functions. I mean, it has to hold for all test functions. But if you have this weak form, you have better convergence. You have convergence order one. So this is h to the power of one here. And this weak convergence is actually the convergence that is relevant to us. Because if you go back to our motivational application here, the university evaluation, university pricing theorem, you see that we have exactly this situation. We have here realizations of the stochastic process at fixed times. Then we have a function of this, okay, and we are only interested in the expectation. So it's enough for us if the expectation of a function of the realizations of the stochastic process converges. So that was a small recap of discretization scheme for stochastic processes. So for example, we may now look at the Black-Scholes model again. Yeah. So I already mentioned here the code for the Euler scheme, and the Euler scheme performs this for any model which we pass into this code. And what is the model? Okay, the model is actually the specification of these parameters here. The coefficients that determines the drift, the coefficients that determine the diffusion, so the factor loadings, and the initial value. Okay, so these guys here are provided by the model. For example, the Black-Scholes model, which we also had on this slide here, is a very simple model. It has, apart from this scaling with n, it has here constant coefficients. So there is here this r, which is a constant. It has a sigma here, and it also has here these initial values. So if you look, we also have some code that specifies a Black-Scholes model. So this is here in this package for the models. And you see that this model specifies the drift, the factor loadings, and the initial value. Yeah. So, and if you look in here, you see this is the Bachelier model. So here we have the Black-Scholes model. Okay, so for the Black-Scholes model, you see that we have here the drift, the factor loadings, and the initial value. So if you look into this code here, yeah, you see that we just have a very simple model with constant coefficients. Yeah, so not a very complicated model. Actually, and now I can use all this to simulate the paths of a stock following the Black-Scholes model. And this here is a small program that does all this. And you see that the program is very short. Yeah. So now all these guys are maybe black boxes to us. So I have the Black-Scholes model, which is just the specification of the parameters. I have a time discretization. Yeah. So here I have 300 time points using 0.01 as a time step size, dt, so very fine. So it goes from 0 to 3. Then I have a Brownian motion, which use is that many sample paths here. Okay, so you can always take a look at the parameters. So the time discretization, the number of factors, the sample paths. And I have the Euler scheme that should be used for this model and this Brownian motion. Yeah, and then I can have a look at the simulation paths. So if you run this, he will create a small plot of my Black-Scholes model. So this is more or less the picture which I wanted to show you, here. Well, you do not see the exponential slope so much. It just uses a little bit diffusive. Well, that's because here my parameter R is small. If you make this parameter larger, then you will indeed see that there is this exponential growth inside the model. So we have this drift. So to finish this, we have a nice toolbox here to explore this, to explore now more complicated models. And all these toolboxes use some numerical methods, and you had a nice little review of these numerical methods. I have a last one here on my recapitulations on my slide, which is the approximations of partial derivatives. Yeah, so because if you recall this replication portfolio, now the replication portfolio can actually be determined by calculating a partial derivative, so which is something like how does the derivative value depend on the stock? Okay, that is actually the answer to the question, how many stock should you buy for your replication portfolio? So that is the partial derivative. So you should differentiate a function with respect to a certain parameter. So if you just think of just functions, so I'm now interested in calculating something like that. Okay, in the first form, you do not see that this guy depends on S. So maybe there should be here the initial value S to make this more explicit. Okay, so how do you calculate the derivative of such a function? Well, you know that you can approximate this by taking a small shift and compare the unshifted value and the shifted value. So f of x plus h minus f of x divided by h. Yeah, so this is a finite difference. And all these finite differences, they actually can be derived from an Taylor expansion. So the approximation of partial derivatives can be derived from Taylor expansions. And here is one small example. So you use the Taylor expansion up to n equals one. Then you get here this expression. So I move v of x to the other side. So you already see there is here the finite difference. Then you divide by h. Okay. And then you see there is here the derivative. And here is the v of x plus h minus v of x divided by h. And this here is your error term, and it is small if h is small. Okay, so you see that this is an approximation for a partial derivative. So if I have here approximated, I cancel this term here because this term here is small for h small. Okay, so and this way of calculating an approximation of a partial derivative indicates that we should use h as small as possible. So a small perturbation, a small shift to our original value. But if we go back to the recapitulation of the computer arithmetic. So that was here. So we remember that using a small value in a computer can lead to problems. And we had studied a nice example for this. The example is differentiate the exponential function. Well, the exponential function looks very well behaved. Yeah. So calculating the partial derivative of the exponential function at zero looks like an easy problem. And if you approximate this, then you have to calculate exponential of x, but x is zero, so x plus h, just h, minus exponential of x, but x is zero, exponential of zero is just one, divided by h. And now if you look at this function as a function of h, this function will look like that. So here below I have h. So actually I have h given on a logarithmic scale. Yeah. So this here is okay, so for the computer, as small as possible is not always a good idea. No? Okay, because we have this issue from computer arithmetic. Yeah, that was my last example of some numerical methods you should be aware of, and a recapitulation of a previous lecture. Again, some part will be used as black boxes, but it's always good to know a little bit about this. Thank you.